Hello and welcome to the Fighting Spirit Podcast. As always, I'm Jason and I'm here to bring you your retrospective for UFC Fight Night, where Justin the Highlight Gaethje put on the highlight reel and knocked out Donald Cowboy Cerrone. And it was a phenomenal contest. It was a good night. It was a great night for us. Went 8-3 on the evening. I'm a little miffed because my own betting strategies didn't pay off. I lost $3 and I had amazing accuracy. I guess I could talk a little bit about that. Just kind of chaps my ass a little bit to, you know, do so well and lose $3. $3 anyways. I guess it could have always been worse, right? All right, let's get into it. Here's the show. Alright, so before we get into the main event, I talked about my betting last night, my betting strategy. I just want to share that we did okay. I lost $3, even though I did okay. So part of that was Duffy in the no contest, right? So I'll get my money back for that one, but obviously, you know, didn't come out with a win. I thought he would have won. We could talk about that a little later, but that obviously didn't work out. And then just two nasty losses. Griffin, Crew, and Krylov kind of screwed me over, and part of that is really my fault. I had other great picks like Sakai out there that I could have used, Smolka, Hubbard, but no, I went with Krylov, and I parlayed it with Gaethje, and I'll talk about why that was a bad idea, and it dawned on me after it happened. I was like, why would I do that? I'm a freaking moron. Anyways, let's talk about the main event. So Justin Gaethje basically shuts down the dad, Cowboy Cerrone. He outstrikes him 2-1. He just has phenomenally fast hands. He threw amazing soccer-like leg kicks. I mean, it was your typical Justin Gaethje-like performance. He was right there in front of Cowboy for the majority. I thought he gave Cowboy a little bit of space to start the fight. I thought Cowboy might actually be able to find some rhythm, but that was not the case. Gaethje has just got lightning in his hands right now, and he is putting you on the canvas if he makes contact. So this is 3 first-round KOs in a row for Gaethje. You know, we talked about him having a rough entry into the UFC, but I think those days are behind him, and he's proven that he should be getting the winner of Tony versus Khabib. I think that is going to be his fight to make. You know, they asked him, DC did in the fight last night, if he would take a fight against an Irishman, and that guy's retired, according to Gaethje. I don't think Connor is going to be fighting Gaethje. I think Connor, if he does come back, not to get too far off of Gaethje right now, but I think he's going to fight a rematch against somebody. Could be somebody like Holloway, although he still has Volkanovski out there. I could see him and Poirier running it back. I think Poirier is confident that he could take him out in their second outing. But I think Gaethje has to sit now, let these contenders like Tony work their way in or out of the system. I can definitely see Tony winning that one, and then we need to put a Gaethje-Ferguson fight. That would be freaking amazing. I mean, those guys just throw such great hands. I can definitely see us getting a Gaethje versus Khabib as well. We still got to wait for an announcement on that next Khabib-Tony fight. I'm thinking it's actually going to be in December. I think it's actually going to be a pretty quick turnaround. I think that Khabib is pretty healthy after his contest with Poirier, and I know Tony's ready to go at the drop of a hat, so I really think that that's what we're going to get, and so I can see Gaethje fighting for the title sometime. You know, it wouldn't be, I wouldn't be so upset if Khabib got some time off to kind of enjoy himself, and we got a July 4th kind of card where Justin Gaethje fights Khabib for the title. I think that's my ideal right now. That would be phenomenal. All right, so we did get that one right. Justin Gaethje defeating Donald Cowboy Cerrone. In the next contest, Glover Teixeira and Nikita Krylov. So this one was so frustrating because I parlayed Nikita Krylov and Justin Gaethje. And it went to a split decision, which it was fair. I've been burned by Glover Teixeira in his last 3 outings. I will still pick what the numbers say going forward here. I don't want to say I'm never going to bet against Teixeira again, and I still like my pick against Krylov. It was a split. It was close. But ultimately, I cannot be making parlays against guys like Glover Teixeira. I got to be smarter about that. I got to be smarter, better about that. Just make mistakes like that, and no matter how good your picks are, you know, if your picks are always good, then it doesn't matter, but you can be stupid. I mean, I had like a 70% chance of having my parlay hit, and that would have been a great payout, and I ended up losing it because it's Teixeira. So or because of Krylov's lack of performance. I thought the first round ultimately did go to Krylov. He ended up in top position to kind of close out the round. Second round, I thought Krylov was actually really tired. He was basically running around. Teixeira was chasing him. He was pointing to the octagon like, hey, like, are we going to fight? Like, what's going on? And Krylov, you know, engages a little bit towards the end. And then third round, I think, went back to Teixeira. I think he locked it up. Granted, Krylov did end up on top position, but he was in a tight guillotine. There's a lot of rough positions. The numbers here don't really tell the whole story. So it's 47 strikes to 43. So Krylov had more. Krylov also scored more takedowns, but he was not effective off of those takedowns. I thought Teixeira basically had him dead to rights every time they were on the mat. There wasn't that much. Actually, you know what? I'm lying. There was actually a good choke on Glover, but Glover is so salty and gritty. He was able to get out of it. Either way, though, he ended up getting this one wrong. It was really razor-thin close. I could have seen them picking Krylov as well, and that would have been really nice to see, but it just didn't play out that way. It just kind of is what it is. And another one that it is what it is, it was recorded as a... Alright, I'm pretty sure they recorded this as a no contest. Yeah, it's a no contest. So Todd Duffy and Jeff Hughes. This is KO here on the website I'm looking at, but that's not right. It says NC next to their names. Todd Duffy and Jeff Hughes. This was good contest. You know, I thought Duffy looked great. You know, he's coming back after a four-year layoff. He gets in there and throws heavy bombs on Jeff Hughes. Heavy bombs. I mean, he looked, Mr. Clean looked like he was getting lit up there for a little while. But dude's tough. You know, he did not crumble to Duffy. Yeah, Duffy was not able to intimidate him and shut him down early. And then we get the eye poke. And it's hard to say what happens in an eye poke. You know, some guys get back. Some guys get, you know, their cornea scratch. Maybe that was the case here. And Todd Duffy, you know, he said he was seeing double. And, you know, I got to really respect the guy for not going out there. You know, a lot of guys will, you know, put their entire careers on the line to go out and make one fight. And this guy, a little older, a little more mature, a veteran, he goes and he says, hey, you know, I can't see. I'm not going to risk it. You know, this guy was injured. That's why he was out. So I definitely can understand why he decided to step away. I think it was totally fair. And I got to respect what Duffy did. I think he ultimately would have won that fight, although I could have seen the tables turning too, especially if Duffy had really burned himself out. But I think that Duffy still would have gotten the victory here, and I got to respect him. Round of applause for that man for, you know, just protecting himself, his family, his career, his life. You know, you don't want to know what could happen if you don't score an early knockdown after, you know, getting your eye poked like that. And so, yeah, no contest here. I didn't count this one on the metric. You can't. So this one was just not counted at all. All right, so I actually hadn't, I guess, been paying attention through the week. Busy with other stuff. So this guy, Tristan Connolly, a local boy from Vancouver, I believe, or at least Canada. I'm not sure exactly where he is right now. Actually, you know, we have the internet. Let's check. The power of the internet, we can see that this guy has no information on this website. All right, I'm pretty sure he's a local guy. Anyways, he's the Boondock. He's Tristan Connolly. And I saw these guys walking out, and I realized that Sergey Honda or Kazakoto, whatever the heck his name was not fighting. He was not going to fight Michael Pereira. And I was like, oh, crap. Oh, this is a debuting bout, too. Like, oh, you know what? Those don't have as much information. Like, I can crunch this right on my phone. So I got my phone out, so I'm punching in numbers, and I'm like, oh, crap. Connolly's going to beat this guy. And I went and posted it to Twitter. Basically, as soon as the fight started, I finished the numbers. And lo and behold, Michael Pereira ends up losing this one. So I'm counting it as a W. It was like a late-breaking W. I tried to post it to Twitter. There's a record out there for these guys fought. It was really interesting fight. So Pereira, he was trying to put on a show, man. He must have thought it was Hollywood. Break dancing, it was Michael Buffer reads his name, jumping off the cage, doing backflips. This guy was interested in doing everything but actually fighting. He wanted like a Showtime kick off the cage, a Superman punch. I don't know, man. It was fun to watch. This is probably one of the most fun UFC fights. And I didn't have any money on it. I wish I did because I would put on Connolly, a super heavy underdog. But I didn't have any money. And this was the most fun, the most interesting fight I saw all night. Connolly was out there to fight, man. He was a Spartan fighting a goofball clown, and he went out there, and he just put the grind on Pereira. He put him on the ground. He boxed him up on the feet, and the highlight reel that we saw in the first round quickly faded into the background, and Pereira just looked terrible at that point in those later rounds. Tristan Connolly just kind of made himself a Canadian star on the evening. He got a $100,000 bonus, plus his payday, plus the contract. I am really happy to see this guy get so much that he deserves. So hats off to Tristan Connolly. Great victory. I kind of called it, not on the podcast, but we did pick up the W for the way I called it. All right, moving on to the next one. This one nearly gave me a heart attack because I had Uriah Hall, and my card for guys I'd bet on were not going too well so far. So this guy was plus 200, Uriah Hall, and I'm like, oh, okay, I really need this one. After, you know, losses like Crew, and who else? Oh, yeah, Griffin losing to Skelly. I was like, I really need this one. So Uriah Hall and Antonio Carlos Jr., this was just kind of a tale of two different worlds. You had Uriah Hall that was lighting up Carlos Jr. on the feet, broke his nose basically right near the start of the first round, and then that was kind of it. He would box him up. He hit him with some really good shots. Not really any kicks, though. I think he was afraid of getting taken down off of a leg kick or a you know, body kick. So he basically tried to keep it, you know, loose with the hands only. And then Carlos Jr. would score takedowns and not really do anything with him. He had over 10 minutes of control, yet lost via split decision. And that's because he didn't do anything on the ground. And I think those are always good calls. I don't like to see a guy that can just neutralize, pick up a W within the allotted time frame. You know, you actually have to win the fight. And I don't think Antonio Carlos Jr. was trying to win the fight. He was just trying to neutralize Uriah Hall. He had nothing to offer him once they were standing, and he really didn't really have much to offer him on the ground. That entire third round was just a body triangle and Uriah Hall laying on his back and Carlos Jr. not able to execute a rear naked choke. You know, Hall was looking at the ref. He was like, hey, come on, stand us up. And to some degree, I actually agreed with Hall. I think if I was the ref, after 3 minutes of, in some points, not even hand fighting, Hall just had his wrist, and, you know, Carlos was just trying to get it free. And so all we're looking at is hand fighting like that. From an entertainment perspective, yeah, you got to stand him up. I get it. From a pure athletics fight perspective, you got to leave them where they are. And I think you got to come somewhere down the middle on this. I think if Hall is defended it and nothing's really happening for Antonio Carlos Jr., then after a minute or two on the ground, if Hall has a stalemate, you might have to stand it up. And that's just to preserve the entertainment aspect of the sport. And I know this is a controversial opinion. That's just where I come down on it. I think if nothing's really happening, the same goes for clinches. You know, there's a lot of clinch work on the cage. You know, there's times where guys aren't really doing anything there. I think they got to be broken up. You know, last night they had the Tyson Fury Wallen fight, and look at how many times they break guys up in the clinch in boxing. You know, boxing clinch work is powerful, you know, but a lot of times they don't really let them work it. You know, they'll break them up really fast. And I think you have to have something similar in the UFC to kind of keep things going and prevent stalling in the sport. And I think that's ultimately what Carlos was doing. I don't think he was working a submission so much. Like, he wasn't trying to punch the rear naked choke. He was stalling, I think, for the most part, because he knew he couldn't beat him. And that's really what I'm saying. If you see somebody stalling, you have to nip it in the bud. You have to stand the guys up. You have to put it back to a neutral ground. Either way, though, we did pick up a W here, so hats off to Uriah Hall. A little ridiculous he called out Israel Adesanya after fighting Shoeface here. But, Hall's a veteran. Let him call him out. I doubt he fights him next. But it'd be interesting to see what he can do against a striker. So he managed to survive against a grappler, shut down a grappler. But it'd be interesting to see what he does here against a middleweight striker now that he's back in control of his career. All right, moving on to the next one. Misha Cirkunov, Jimmy Crute, lost this one. Ah, man. So Crute nearly had him out. I thought the ref might pull the hook, but Crute's going at it, and he slips over the top of Cirkunov. Cirkunov gets his back, and boom, Peruvian necktie. Crute kind of, I think, made a rookie mistake. The guy's 23 years old, never been defeated before, never really had too much adversity. And he ended up just making a mistake that cost him a lot. I think Crute still should have won that fight. He just made an error, man. And that's just MMA. You know, that is the way this sport operates. Guys can make mistakes and still win. Guys can make mistakes that are winning and still lose. And it was a big mistake, costly mistake. You know, it's not like other sports where you make a big mistake in the first half, you come back in the second half, and you correct. You have to actively correct or you're going to lose. And that's what we saw happen here. So Jimmy Crew will be back. I'll probably be picking him again. I think he's going to learn from this mistake. He's young, and this is going to be the kind of thing that happens to a guy and catapults him to become a better fighter later on in the career. So hats off to Misha Cirkunov here. He got performance of the night money, and hats off to Crew. I think you're going to be back, man. I don't think that you're going to let this slip up, pull down your career. I think you're only going to get better from here. So I look forward to calling your fights in the future, but we did take an L. Then we got Augusto Mambubi Sakai defeating Marcin Tybura. By the way, Sakai looking a little bit svelte. Right? He weighed in like in the 250s, down off his 265s. His fupa was looking a little thinner. His Mambubi was looking a little smaller. You know, he didn't have to fight with a sports bra out there. He was looking good. I'm making way too much fun of Augusto Sakai. Actually, let's just call the fights themselves. Hopefully you get a laugh, though. So Augusto Sakai, man, the guy swings wrenches for hands. Marcin Tybura, this guy never really performs, I think, to his capabilities, but he gets put on the cage, and basically Sakai just punches his way to victory. He hits him again and again with his wrench of a hand and right in the temple until he just goes out on his feet, takes a couple more down below, and then the ref jumps and tries to pull him off 59 seconds into the first round, and, it was just a good contest by Augusto Sakai. The guy is a great fighter. Look forward to calling more for him. Maybe I'll cut back on making fun of him. But I keep picking him for fights. So if I keep picking him, I think he can do it. It's just, he just has a terrible body shape for heavyweight, for professional athletics. Let's just put it that way. He's got the shape of a bowler, professional. If he was on the PBA, I would be saying shit. He'd just be par for the course. Anyways, moving on. Miles Johns defeats Cole Smith. Actually, I wasn't really able to see this one. I had to step out for a little while. But Miles Johns pretty much handily defeats Cole Smith. 31 strikes to 11. It was a split decision, though. I think Cole Smith early on had a lot of takedowns. He was the hometown kid as well. But he was not able to execute his game plan and picked up an L. In what I did call correct, though, Hunter Azure defeats Brad Katona. This was an interesting contest. So I thought Azure had the better boxing. He outstruck Katona by 20 strikes. But Katona kept pressing a wrestling game against a guy that is a Montana State wrestling champion. Very interesting stuff. Azure's takedown defense was decent, but Katona just kept pressing the effort, and he ended up scoring 3 takedowns, and I thought he looked okay on the ground. You definitely can tell Katona, if it wasn't in his mindset going in, he's just been working a lot of grappling recently. Over at SBG, obviously John Kavanaugh is a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt, and I think they were trying to work that into his game. I don't think it was ultimately the best time to play that out, though. I would have liked to see Katona employ better striking and not try to just grind this thing out, because that's definitely not his strong suit. Maybe he needs to work on it, but you don't want to work on it in the cage. So again, Katona takes another loss. I like Katona. I think he finally will bounce back. You can tell his game is still evolving. And I think Hunter Azure has good things in store for him. His boxing looked good, especially for bantamweight. Looked like he had some good power. Those knockdowns against Katona, I think, really sealed the deal. And he picked up an excellent win for us. So hats off to Azure. Then in another one, Chaz Skelly, Jordan Griffin. I was so frustrated by this. Holy hell. So Chaz Skelly, amazing, phenomenal grappler. Right? Amazing, phenomenal dad bod as well. Jordan Griffin, excellent striker. Trains over at Duke Rufus. Over at Rufus Sport, and he has Skelly dead to rights on the feet every time. However, every time Skelly gets him on the ground, it's his world, and he's just dominating Griffin. So what does Griffin do? He tries to execute takedowns and grappling exchanges with a guy that he's getting outclassed with the entire time. You're beating him up on the feet. This is a low fight IQ situation. When you are as good as Griffin is on the feet, do everything in your power to stuff takedowns, stay away from the cage, circle out, and keep boxing and throwing leg kicks. Keep it standing. God, some guys just have low fighting. I thought he was a better fighter. I thought he could have neutralized Skelly, but instead, he put it to the ground himself, and he ended up paying the price. I ended up losing money on this one, so I'm a little bit salty about Griffin. I think he should have executed his game plan. Would he be a complete mixed martial artist if he, just tried to keep his standing? No, but some people have a perfectly fine career by stuffing takedowns and boxing people's faces off. Griffin needs to employ that kind of strategy. Granted, you get taken to somebody else's world. It is what it is, and you need to defend that, but he did an okay job defending. I can't say Griffin looked terrible on the ground, but he couldn't get up. Skelly smothered him. He was like a goddamn weighted blanket out there. Had him held down, and near dead to rights. So Griffin outscores Skelly with strikes, but that's not the tale of this one. Skelly goes for multiple submission attempts. Griffin submission attempts as well, but I didn't think he had really had any real chance there. Anyways, taking out on this one, it is what it is. So the first two fights, I didn't put any money on, but I do kind of kick myself now. You picked them both correctly. Luis Smolka knocks out Ryan McDonald. Smolka with just phenomenal hands, moving up to bantamweight. He looked really good, probably didn't have to cut much weight, and just an awesome fight overall. Knocks him out in the first round. And then Austin Hubbard picks up a win against Kyle Prepolic. And I was not able to see that one, but it looks like he basically outstruck him. Hubbard ends up with 3 takedowns, 4 passes on the ground. He just performed better overall and deserved to get that win. So, all right. So, we went 8-3 on the evening. We did have that no contest out there, which I'm just not counting for anything because, you can't adjust for eye poke. So, we had a really good night. Like I said, my gambling strategy was crap, but I think part of that's because I got away from kind of what's gotten me to the dance, me to kind of do fairly well with the gambling. I'm still, gaining traction from the last couple of weeks where, we had some L's. But, I gotta really just, because I only took 7 fights. I only bet on 7 fights. One of those was a parlay. I really got to spread the risk around. That's what it's about. I broke from my own game plan. I thought I had a good idea. I thought I was going to come out on top. And Glover Teixeira decided not to let that happen. And that is what it is. I just got to be more disciplined in the actual gambling itself. You do too. That's why I give all the picks out here. Take all of them. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. And that's what I did. I put them really into a smaller basket. I needed a bigger basket to spread that risk around. And if I had spread the risk around, I would have done a lot better tonight. I would have won a couple bucks instead of losing a couple bucks guaranteed. And it just is what it is. You gotta accept it. And I talk about it. It's my own personal therapy to let myself know it's going to be okay. losing $3 ain't the end of the world. It's just frustrating. All right. I've definitely had way worse nights. That's for sure. Does anybody remember the UFC Moscow card? It went like 1-6. I remember it. I never want to be there again. All right. So that brings us we got another show coming up. We're going to be let's take a look here. We're going to be over in Mexico City. So we got Rodriguez versus Steven. So you got Ear versus Jeremy, and what should be a pretty good contest. We actually, just to the sidebar, the Mexican Independence Day, just talk a little bit about that Tyson Fury fight. So Mexican Independence Day was yesterday, and it's become kind of a boxing holiday. I didn't really know this. I was watching ESPN after the fights last night. And Tyson Fury goes out there. He has an amazing walkout. He had a mariachi band. He's on a stage for a sombrero, a poncho. He has Mexican, accented boxing gloves. And it just, the showmanship of this guy is unreal. He gets in the ring, and I didn't think he looked that great to start. I'm no boxing expert by any stretch of the imagination. I'll make this breakdown kind of short, but you could see Fury, he didn't look that sharp in the first 2-3 rounds. I thought actually that Wallen was actually winning. It turns out the judges only saw 1 round for Wallen on that one, but I thought he was winning the first 2 rounds. He looked a little bit slower. He looked as willing to engage Fury, and Wallen was looking to bring the fight to him. Next thing you know, Wallen cracks Fury with this great, I think it was a left hand, and cracks him on the head real clean, opens up a really nasty cut. This cut's bad. Go on the internet, look at it. Basically has one cut kind of on his eyelid, and then maybe like a centimeter of skin just above the eyebrow, and then another cut. It's like a 2-3-inch gash. It's pretty nasty stuff, and they're rubbing Vaseline in it, and Wallen's getting dirty about it. He keeps trying to punch him in the cut, and that's a strategy. I get it. That's a fair strategy when you get a doctor stoppage via TKO, but at some point, the ref goes to break up a clinch, and he just shoves his glove in it, just rubbing it in, trying to open it up and make it worse. So that was some real dirty pool by Wallen. I don't know. I think it was just in the moment. Both guys were frustrated, I think, at some points, especially Fury. Like, Fury with the cut and learning about, the stoppage, and that guy, oh, man, Fury turned it on later on. He beat the hell out of this guy, I'd say, from around, 7, 8, and on. There was nothing in it for Wallen. Guy was tired as hell. He put it all on the line real early, and he wasn't able to defeat a slow-starting Tyson Fury. I think Tyson Fury maybe didn't take the kid as seriously going into it. I think he would definitely take Deontay Wilder seriously, because now they're talking about that contest. And as a total sidebar, the commenting for ESPN last night was freaking terrible. All right. So I think everybody just expected Fury to go out there and fight like 2-3 rounds with this kid, right? Put him on the canvas early, like his last outing, and just shut the door. So they're talking about like, oh yeah, when Fury fights Wilder, this, and his performance has to be amazing to seal the deal on this. You know, they weren't even giving me commentary on what was happening. They weren't like, oh man, that was a really nice jab there behind his cross. Other way around. Really nice jab there behind his cross, behind his jab. Whatever. It was terrible. Like, I felt like I was watching a commercial for Tyson Wilder 2 rather than a fight that Tyson could have easily lost. You know, it's just, I don't know. It was weird. You know, it'd be like if all of a sudden Joe Rogan just started talking about how epic Tony Ferguson versus Khabib was or would be in the end of the first round in you know, Abu Dhabi. Like, all right, Dustin's losing this one, pretty clear. Let's talk about what's in the future ahead. And then, you know, a couple minutes later, Fury, the heck is it? Dustin is a wobbling Khabib, and you know, you gotta kind of shut up what you're talking about. Anyway, I'm getting all rambly. I really, you know, I don't talk about boxing. I shouldn't talk about boxing. I don't know what I'm talking about. But either way, hats off Tyson Fury. I do look forward to him watching him fight Deontay Wilder. I think it'll be an interesting contest for sure. So we got the fight night coming up that we'll have those picks out again. I think I'll be getting them out a little bit earlier than Tuesday, but Tuesday is our deadline. I have some other stuff going on in life where I kind of try to take care of it a little bit earlier. So if they come out a little earlier, I don't think you'll be too disappointed. Hopefully all the fights stay aligned. We did miss out on picking up, what was it, Tristan Connolly in this last one, just because of the late replacements. Those always do happen. And then we also had the liquor review for the Spirit Patreon-driven Spirit Reviews come out last Thursday. So check that one out. And yeah, let's do a little housekeeping. Get in touch with the Fighting Spirit Podcast at fightingspiritpodcast@gmail.com. We're also on Twitter at MMAFightPicks01. And that's probably the best social media platform to get in touch with me at this point. I do have an Instagram and I do have a Facebook, but the Facebook page, I feel like, is basically dead. You know, I've paid to advertise the page and everything. It's very stagnant. I get way more interaction, way better follows from Twitter. And so that's kind of my social media platform of choice at this time. I think it has the best growth potential for the show. It's got the highest level of engagement for me. And I think that's the way to keep in touch with us. So as much as you can update the Facebook page if you're on there, you know, go for it. I just don't post as much. So if you're exclusively on Facebook, not on Twitter, I would recommend getting there to get more, go there to get more content. And, you know, I wasn't a fan of Twitter until I actually started using it myself. So check me out there. Also, I mentioned the Patreon earlier. Please like, support the show if you like. I do appreciate that. We also have, let's see, we have Spotify. We're on your podcast platform of choice. Please get out there. At this point, you're probably already listening to me on your podcast platform of choice, whatever that may be. So I do appreciate that as well. All right, I'm rambling a bit, kind of a longer show. We had a good night, 8-3. I'm always hoping to do better, but that's really, I think, as good as you can do in these things. There's just too many what-if factors to really get better than 70%, but we're back in it. We hit the mark yesterday. I'm proud of it. I wish the money would, you know, kind of show that, but that is what it is. And actually, I want to give one other sidebar, and this is a No, you know what? That's posted to Twitter. If you want to know what different experimental thing I'm working on, go to Twitter. Take a look at it there. All of that information was just posted right before I went live with this podcast, and I think that's where that stuff's going to live. I don't think I'm going to do a separate thing for this thing. But you know what? If you have listened to this point, why don't you write #FightingSpirit on the weird oddball thing that I just put out on my Twitter. If you put #FightingSpirit, I will read whatever the heck you write on the show for sure. I mean, I'd read it anyways, but I'll know that you got this far into my podcast and you actually follow me on Twitter. So put #FightingSpirit on the thing that I just posted that has nothing to do with the UFC. That has a totally different implication. So go look at that. You'll know when you see it. And until I speak with you again, happy fight picking.